we have discussed about CMOS inverter. And in CMOS inverter, there are several things that we have discussed. We have discussed about noise margin. We have discussed about chip area. We have discussed about critical voltage points. And we have also discussed how we can go for mathematical calculation of critical voltage points. So in this video, we are going to discuss about your CMOS inverter dynamic analysis and design. So what we are going to discuss in this module consists of five different topics. We will be covering them one by one. The first thing we are going to discuss is MOS capacitances. Till now, we have not discussed much about MOS capacitances, but right now, it is the particular time or correct time at which we can discuss about MOS capacitance. After MOS capacitance is over, we can go forward for MOS inverter with its capacitances, and then we will go for mathematical calculation of delay that is involved in an inverter. So once we have definition of delay and all, we go for calculations. And last but not the least, how we are going to design with all the constraints which we are having till date. So what are the various constraints we are having? We know about noise margin. We know about your critical voltage points. Now we will be moving towards inverter design when we also knowing your delay constraints. So delay mainly involves your propagation delay, how your output is delayed when you're applying input to the system. So now we will be discussing about MOS capacitances. So MOS capacitances can be classified into three different categories. Number one is structure capacitances. That means owing to the MOS structure, your device is having particular kind of capacitance. That is the first kind of capacitances we are talking about. Second kind of capacitances is channel capacitances. That means the channel is having some sort of capacitance that we are going to involve in the discussion. Third kind of capacitances that are there is because of your depletion regions, reverse bias PN junctions of the drain and source. So all of them fall under the category intrinsic capacitances. That means related to the MOS. There are other capacitances that are extrinsic capacitances. That means that is outside the domain of your inverter, because inverter is not operating individually. It is to be operated with other circuits. When all the circuits are being combined, then capacitances due to those comes under the category extrinsic capacitances. So this is your MOS structure. You are already aware of this. This is your gate. And first have a cross-section analysis of this. So this is your MOS structure. This is the cross-section of the structure. Here you can find out that this is your oxide. This is your gate, polysilicon gate. This is your source. This is your drain. And this is related to your insulation. And this is your substrate. So this is your cross-section layer. Now you have a look at that. And from the top view, what you will find out that there is certain overlapping. Technically, if you go for this, what should be there? It should be end up like this, crisp things. But due to several processes, your wet etching or maybe some dispersion of the carriers while you are doping them using ion implantation in these regions. So some structure is there under the gate oxide. So this leads to several kind of capacitances, which we are going to discuss. They falls under the category overlap capacitances. So here you can find out your gate electrode overlaps source and drain regions. Here your gate is actually overlapping source and drain regions, and XT is overlap length on each side of the channel. So here you can see that some portion here and some portion here is actually overlapped. So your effective channel length is now overall channel length minus LD, where is your channel length due to overlapping. So overall capacitance is this. That means gate source capacitance. This is gate drain capacitance. So this gives you overall capacitance, overlap capacitance. So till date, we only know that there is one capacitance, that is oxide capacitance. But now we know that due to overlapping, there is some sort of capacitances in the device. So these are the pictures which you give you a good idea what are the various capacitances in your MOSFET. Suppose this is your MOSFET, and we know that MOSFET is having four different terminals. Your gate is there, drain is there, source is there, and body is there. So between gate and drain and body, gate and body, this capacitance is there, CGB. Between gate and drain, this capacitance is there. Similarly, gate and source, CGS is there. Similarly, substrate and body, CSB is there. And then drain and body, CDB is there. So this subscript actually gives you the terminals by connecting them, what kind of capacitance you are actually having. So here you can see, this is your source, this is your body. So gate and source is having some capacitance, gate and drain is having some capacitances, then gate and body is having some capacitances. So all these capacitances are there. So they come into existence. So why we are doing this entire analysis? Because if you go for the calculation, what happens? Individually, you have to take care of all of them. But that's not a good thing as far as your calculations are concerned and your complexities are being concerned. So what you can do, you can reduce this entire capacitances. So these are the capacitances in inverter. What we are actually going for, we will reduce this entire capacitances into a single capacitance called C load. So now I will be discussing what are the capacitances you are going to include in C load and what are the capacitances which are not being included in the C load. So here, this is the inverter, CMOS inverter, you already know. But the thing is, the kind of CMOS inverter we have discussed is quite simple. You are having PMOS, you are having NMOS, and that's all. But now we have actually included different capacitances related to your device. So please pay attention onto this. This is your gate. This is your output. Okay, this is drain. So what you will find out that I am giving the subscripts as CGSP. So this denotes capacitance between gate terminal and source terminal of PMOS, CGSP. Similarly, here you can find out CSBP. That means capacitance between source and body of PMOS. Here, capacitance between gate and drain of PMOS. Here you can find out your capacitance between drain and body of PMOS. And so on, we will get capacitance for gate and drain of NMOS. Here, drain body for NMOS, and so on. Here, one thing you should observe that for this particular capacitance, your source is at VDD, your body is at VDD. So if you are putting equal potential on both the sides of the capacitance, what will happen? This is not working as capacitance. So we can eliminate such capacitance. So this will be eliminated. Similarly, source and body for NMOS. So source is grounded, your body is grounded. So this can be eliminated. Other capacitances that are to be eliminated are CGSP and CGSN. Now you can ask why we are eliminating this. The reason for their elimination is, initially when your input is zero, so NMOS is zero, that means this will be eliminated. When your input is zero, both are at zero, so this will be eliminated. Now when your input is high, so this gate is high and source is high, again this is eliminated. So that's why we eliminate these capacitances. Now this is a very wonderful illustration of various kinds of capacitances that we find out when we are actually cascading the CMOS inverter. So here you can find out that this is the capacitor inverter we are working with. This this is your output, and this is your capacitance, that is intrinsic capacitance, and that's related to your CMOS inverter. So here you can find out this is gate capacitance of the next stage, because this inverter is not operating in isolated manner. It is to be connected with some other inverter. So what happens? This is being connected with the other circuit. So here you can find out that this has to encounter a capacitance. And what is this capacitance? CG. This is capacitance of the next stage. That means gate capacitance of the next stage. So slowly and slowly we will understand them. So what is the main motive of discussing this particular slide is that what are the various capacitances that are associated with your CMOS inverter? What are the various capacitances that we are actually going to eliminate? And what are those which are we are going to keep in the entire discussion? And we are doing this entire exercise so that we can eliminate all the capacitances and reduce them to form a single capacitance of C load. And why we are doing this entire exercise? Because suppose this is your zero. So what happened? This is on, this is off. So now your capacitance is charging. So your capacitance is basically pulled up using PMOS. Similarly, when this is high, what happened? This is off. And now your capacitor is discharging using this. So now your entire exercise is being reduced to study charging and discharging of this particular capacitor. And this gives us quite a convenient way for analysis. That's why we go for such kind of discussion. Okay, next is, what are the capacitances which we have kept and what are the capacitances which we have not kept? So here you can see in C load we have CGDN, CGDP, CDBN, CDBP, C intrinsic, that is the intrinsic capacitance of your MOS, and CG is gate capacitance of the next stage. So in which this is your intrinsic component, C in interconnect capacitance, that means when you are actually connecting one inverter with another inverter, then what happens? That is to be done with the help of some metallic connection, that is interconnect. And third is your gate capacitance, that is thin oxide over the gate area for the next stage. So I hope things are getting quite simpler now. So I am moving ahead now. So this is the topic which I was discussing, that I have eliminated some of the capacitances, so exclusion of capacitances from the equation. In particular, CSBN have no effect on the transient behavior of the circuit, since the source to substrate voltages of both the transistors are always equal to zero. Both are at same or at VDD. Then the capacitance CGSN and CG are also not included because they are connected between the input node and the ground or the power supply. So I have discussed that. So these set of capacitances we are not including in our discussion. So once you have eliminated your capacitance, then next thing you can do is you will reduce your entire expression to this particular thing. That means when your input is high, only NMOS is on, so PMOS is off. So whatever charge we have stored in the previous cycle will be discharged. So this current is called IDN. If IDP is there, that is current due to PMOS. This is current due to IDN. So the entire thing is now reduced to finding the charge up and charge down times of single capacitance, which is charge and discharge through one transistor. This is the entire thing we are going to discuss. That means if you are going to charge up or pulling up the charge, PMOS is involved. We are going in this particular manner. And if you are using NMOS, then it will go in this particular fashion. So this is quite a simple thing now. So now we have discussed about MOS capacitances. We have discussed about MOS inverter with its capacitances. Now we are going to discuss about definition of delay in an inverter. Because anywhere in any circuit, if some capacitance is involved, what sort of problem you're getting? You're getting delay, because some sort of time is being spent while charging up or charging down the capacitance. Okay, so here you can see this is your inverter. This is your VUH. You are already aware of this. This is your VUL. You are aware of this. Now, there is a line of V50%. That means when voltage is 50%, this is the line to be drawn. So here you can see one is square wave input, but right now we are not focusing on this. We are having this kind of thing. So this is your actual thing, and this is your ideal thing. So right now we assume that you're, so now what happens? Your input changes from 0 to 1, your output will start falling from high to, is not an instantaneous thing. It takes some finite amount to discharge. So that is point of concern. So when you talk about delay, delay says that when your input is 50%, and corresponding to your input, when your output reaches 50%, then the time lapse between these two things is called tau PHL. That means propagation delay whenever high to low transition is there. So once again, I repeat, when your input is 50%, your input is at 50% level, and your output responds and reaches 50% level, then the duration lapse between these two timelines is called high to low propagation delay. So if your input reaches at V50% at time T0, and your output reaches at 50% at time D1, then T1 minus T0 is tau PHL. Okay, so same is the case when your input falls. So when your input falls from high to low, so mind it, here we are assuming that your input is actually perfect square wave, idealized step input. Actually, it is like that, but here for simplicity, we are assuming that it is an idealized input. So here, what you will find out again, when you talk about delay, so here we are having input from high to low and your output from low to high transition. So your delay for high to low transition is being, again, when your input falls to 50% that time and your output rises to 50%. So this delay is called tau PLH. So I hope you get both the definitions. One is for when your output falls from 1 to 50%, VUH to 50%, and when your output raises from 0 to 50%. So these two delays, T1 minus T0 and T3 minus T0, so one is called tau PHL, other is called tau PLH. So the average of these two is actually called propagation delay. So propagation delay is not a simple definition like that, that when your input is delayed, input is applied and output is delayed, so the delay between output and input, that is called propagation delay. Actually, a propagation delay is sum of two factors. One is tau PHL, other factor is tau PLH. So what is tau PHL? That is propagation delay whenever your output is having transition from high level to low level, and when your high level reaches 50%, then delay between this is called tau PHL. Similarly, when your output rises from VOL to V50%, then this is called tau PLH. So average of these two is called your propagation delay. Okay, so when your output falls from V90 to V10%, suppose your voltage is 1 volt. So from 0.9 volt to 0.1 volt, the time taken by output to fall from 90% of the VDD to 10%, that is called fall time. Similarly, when your output rises from 10% to 90% to rise, that is called rise time. So these factors are very, very important and must be remembered by a student to get a better understanding. What are those factors? Tau PHL, tau PLH, and your fall time and rise time. So here you can see, this is your, in the one in the pink is your idealized step input. So V50% is actually VOL plus VOH minus VOL over 2. Okay, so this comes out to VOH over VOL over 2. So this is your V50%. So tau PHL is T1 minus T0 and PLH is T3 minus T2. And your propagation delay is average of these two. Now coming to words. Rise time or fall time. So V10% is equal to VOL plus 0.1 of VOH minus VOL. Again, once again, I'm giving you this particular description. Please focus at this particular area. So what is V10%? V10% is equal to VOL. VOL, that is the minimum voltage corresponding to logic zero level, and 0.1%. 0.1, 10% means that VOH minus VOL. So that gives you 10%. And V90% is VOL plus 0.9 of VOH minus VOL. So fall time is TV minus TA. That means 90% to 10%. How much time your device is actually taking, that is called fall time. Similarly, rise time is TC minus TD. That means your device, how much time your device is taking to rise, that is TC minus TD. Okay, actually it is TD minus TC. So make the correction. It is TD minus TD because we have to subtract smaller from the bigger. So TD is larger and TC is smaller. So similarly, TV minus TA, this is TD minus TC and so on. So we have a good discussion on delay time definitions and capacitances. Now, the next thing we are going to discuss is calculation of delay times. So we will be going to discuss this in the next class. So this is for today's discussion. And I expect you people that you get a very good understanding of the topics which I was discussing. So over to you people.